And welcome back.
Welcome back, Darren.
It's good to be back.
What have you been doing for these last 10 minutes?
Is it 10 minutes? It flies by.
It flies like crazy.
Yep.
Did you get a drink?
I did.
Me too. I'm happy.
When we hit branded.
Let's talk about Module 3. Let's cover a couple things real quick. First of all, we're going to go through a lot of demos. Every single demo, almost, we have. Will be is available on xaml.codeflex.com. You can download it yourself, go through it with us, look at all the code, as well as the Jumpstart app that we created that kind of brings all of the things we're talking about today into a single app. I think I'll submit that to the store this week.
Sounds good. A notable exception is there will be no demo on Norwegian in the uploaded code.
Just check that in, right? You're
exactly,
all right.
Exactly. Yeah.
But no, the demo is doing it yourself. It's
exactly.
Like a lab.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so this is Module 3, Day 3, Module 3, Advanced XAML. We'll be talking about branding your application.
Yep.
Basically making your app very unique to you. Very unique. That's what it's about, differentiations.
We just did responsive design, and the next module after this one will be reusable controls.
That's right. That's going to be good.
It's going to be
good. Look what's after that, meal break.
That's awesome.
It's going to be great. Yeah. I wonder what time it is in Norway right now. All right. They've already eaten. It's all fish for them. Salty fish.
Now, move on. Okay.
Delicious, though.
Custom styles.
I've been to North Point. It's at the North Moat. You know what
I've been
is.
To Tromsø.
Really?
Yeah. Tromsø, Stavanger.
You have been around, man. That's
absolutely.
Awesome.
Oslo.
All right. So, anyway, so we'll talk about custom styles, and then we'll go into the extended splash. This is both... A branding exercise as well as a performance piece, right? We'll talk about that when we get into the splash. And then secondary tiles, and we'll talk about how secondary tiles can make your application extremely valuable to your end user. So we'll begin with custom styles. And of course, styles allow you to take the exact same controls and make them look slightly different, right? Mm-hmm. You can retemplate them, of course, and make them look dramatically different. Or you can just change their style subtly. You know, we have a lot of experience with this in CSS, where we can change our application to be, let's say, like high contrast versus mm-hmm. whatever the normal colors might be, or subtly change it to be branded for whoever it is you're looking
and
at.
Of course,
it needs to be blue.
We actually do have those themes as part of the Windows 8 environment that we can select light or dark, high contrast, high visibility, and so on and so forth.
That's right.
Those things are actually built into the application environment as well.
They are. I'm glad you mentioned that because I hadn't even thought about that till just now. And of course, we as developers can select that.
Mm-hmm.
In a similar to the language toolkit, or not the toolkit, but the resource file, that's not a designer issue as well. It's always dark in the designer unless you go into devices and try and preview it.
Exactly.
In fact, let me. I'm going to pull up a... So I have a URL, the AKMS... W8 style. So I've already gone through. I wrote a blog article on this. That's all that is. But I want to kind of show.
So you're just going to sit back and say, "Go read my website."
So go. We're going to take a 5-minute break while everybody goes. That'd be sweet. All right. So I'm going to pull up your scaling project.
Okay.
Remember the one? It all it has is a picture in the middle, and so the 100 is really nice. And I want to go through kind of how I would style this, right? Mm-hmm. Not how I would adjust the styles. So I think first it's important to go to AppXAML. That is the application scoped set of styles. This is where you would make changes to the styling of your application so that it affects everything inside your app. And you can create resources, you can create full style sets, you can create templates here. I'm going to create just a color, and I'll call it, it's going to be X key. X key of my color.
And we're putting a key in there because we're adding something to a dictionary, yes?
We're putting a key in here because we're adding something to a dictionary. Yes. Well, yes, that's right. Because if we did X name instead of X key, that would mean we could reference it from the code, and you can't reference something at this scope from the code. Right, you're exactly right.
Yeah, we're adding it to a resource dictionary, so we have the key value, and that's how we'll find it.
It is indeed, yeah. And in fact, we'll see it. It will become a static resource on the global scope. And so that we'll start with orange. I know that's your favorite color. What color is the Norwegian flag? Do you know?
I should.
I should too. I've got their jersey. Okay, I'm sure it's red. All right, so Here, so I'm going to go to the background of this grid, and now when I go over to its properties, of course I love using the properties dialog, and I go to the properties, I can change its color. You can see now I can change it to be red, but I also has this little square block which allows me to interact with the resources and bindings. So I'll go ahead and select that, and you can see I can pick from a local resource, and local to this page, because I made it at the global scope, is my color, what I just created. So now when I select that, it no longer is what I am selecting, this kind of red color, but it's now, and you can see the syntax down here at the bottom, and let me kind of make that just a hair bigger. You can see the syntax down here at the bottom, it calls it out as a static resource. Static resource simply means that the value of that resource will not change dynamically, right? It is what you read it as is what it will always be. In WPF, we had dynamic resources where you could actually change things out from under and kind of pull the rugs on the value of things. Static resources, what we have in Windows 8, only static resources. And so now I've selected orange. If I were to go back now to my app XAML and change this orange now to, let's say, steel blue, which really is one of my favorite colors, and then go back, you can see it now it's changed it again. This is great. Now I can start going through and coloring everything, pulling out all of the hard-coded colors, hard-coded sizes and borders and things like that, pulling them up into the AppXAML so that I can set them up. Now, that's nice, but I want to talk a little bit about theming, because when I create a style, I can group them together as an individual theme. And so we've done this in our Jumpstart application. In fact, I'm just going to leave this app here and jump down to our Jumpstart. Jump to our Jumpstart, Darren. That's what I'm going to do.
Skip to it.
Yeah. All right. So now I'm going to open up the app XAML here. It's a little bit more complete, but I only want to show kind of this first section. So there's two parts to the resource dictionary inside the application. The first one is this bottom section, which is all the kind of freehand stuff that you've just added, kind of like the color that I just did. Mm-hmm. But also I have this merge dictionaries. That's the other section. And it's basically me pulling in files, different files that I want to include in the global scope. So this could become a very long file, and so being able to break it out into separate files makes sense. But see, what I've done here is I've also broken it out into an individual color. So these are all the styles related to green. And when it's green, then this is why, right? Everything that's green is in styles, custom styles.green.xaml. I like to say, I like to put the color right in the file name just so I don't get confused. Mm-hmm. And so if I were to open up that resource dictionary, not a res W like we were talking before, yep. This is a XAML resource dictionary. If I were to open that up, it would be everything needed to make something a color. I think there's a caveat that developers should know about here. If you're going to have different templates that interact with the color, they need to be separated out. So, for mm-hmm. example, this is a green. This is the green one. And I have this data template here. And this data template uses, right here, the primary color. See, primary color is set up here as green, and then it's used here inside this data template. They need to be together because the data templates render as they're loaded, so they don't dynamically change. If I took this data template and said, I'd really like to just put it in the app XAML and then just let it reference that color, that would work fine until I wanted to change the color. They've already been rendered. We were talking earlier about static and dynamic resources. They don't update until you restart the entire application.
And there's a good reason for that, optimization. It saves you having to keep going round and round and round and re-rendering all of those things.
Yeah, I've heard of developers losing a lot of time not knowing about that because they can't figure out why things are updating. So I'm going to run the app again and kind of show where we're headed with all of this. So the app loads. It's got a nice green background. It's still loading here. I should have had it preloaded. There it is. It's a beautiful app, though.
It is.
It really is nice.
Look at that.
It's a handsome app, I think, is the word I was shooting for.
Well, half of it is, for sure.
It is. I wonder, we may not agree on everything in that. Doesn't matter. Okay. And the Star Trek advertisement.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Are you a Trekkie?
I'm a Trekker, but that's okay. All right, so I'm going to go into the settings of the app. Of course, we'll talk about how to implement settings later, but I just want to show what it does. There's quite a few settings in the app here, and one of them here, I can pick from four different colors. Of course, you can see it's green is green. But if I wanted to change it to red, I select red, and the application changes to red. Red background. You can see the highlighting on the individual template is red as well. If I went and changed it to orange or yellow or whatever that kind of color is, the background changes. You can see the highlighting here changes. And anything else that might be affected.
And in common with the theme throughout this whole Darren, presentation, you are not a designer.
Darren, this is beautiful. You have no appreciation for art. All right. All right, so this is kind of what we want to implement, right?
Exactly.
Not just the ability to have styles, which is important, but the ability to have sets of styles grouped together as themes and swap between them so that users have control, or maybe you need to do this programmatically only based on something like you recognize the user, you know, all of your administrators get this theme, all of your users get this theme, or whatever,
sure.
Right?
You know, not every application is going to need something like this in terms of being user switching and so on and so forth. But if you as a developer are building a foundational framework that you're going to reuse across multiple Windows 8 App Store apps, having this as a baseline capability that you've got so that you can easily change the overall theme and brand of your application. You know, for example, you know, there's some templates out there that allow you to build these info style apps that consume information. And depending upon your info source.
I've heard of those. Like the ones at w8templates.codeplex.com?
I think those ones.
I've heard of those. Very powerful.
You know, when you're bringing in information from different news feeds, each of those news feeds may well be branded. And so the ability to be able to move between those brandings is very, very powerful.
Yeah, you're right. And not just changing colors, but you can do it dramatically.
Yeah,
right?
Based bringing different image logos, so on and so forth.
Yeah, because inside a resource dictionary can control everything.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you can edit the styles, you can edit everything.
The key is being able to do it dynamically, and I think that's what you're going to show.
That's where we're headed. That's exactly right. So I want to bring us back so we can look again at AppXAML. So this is AppXAML again, and so it has these two parts. It's kind of freehand, all of the pieces down here that you might use, right? In this case, it's got a few styles. It's got a few data templates, but more importantly, it has these merged dictionaries. If we are going to swap between these two, right? So I change it so it's no longer green, but now that it's orange. I basically need to rebuild this in code. That's the way to do it. And it's easy enough, right? All I really need to do is create a new resource dictionary. That's all that this is. And then set that resource dictionary to the resources property of the application. Let's look at how we do it.
Yep.
And so I have it right here. I just forgot where it was. It's in navigation. Of course it is. All right. So in colors, let me just scroll to it, and okay. So all right, I just forgot where it was. Dang, I just had a total brain loss. Colors.
Okay. What's the method?
I'll find it here. It's great. Color setup color. It's called setup color. It's ridiculous. This is the Norwegian curse, is what it is.
Exactly.
Change color.
Somewhere there is a country laughing.
Change. Colors, dang it. All right, so it's going to be in, I still don't know, doggone it.
It's searching for green. So color string equals, so it's in your splash.xaml.
Of course it is, that is where it should be. All right, good, all right. So it's in the splash
106,
view.
Line 106.
I don't need, yes, thank you, I appreciate that. All right, now here's the method to actually I was searching for color, I should have been searching for theme. All right, there it is. Okay, so remember, if we were looking at the AppXAML, what we need to do is recreate whatever is in the resources. And so the first thing we do is, in fact, let's skip this part. This is just me picking between which resource we want. So this one's picking red, green, blue, or orange. Again, all of this is at xaml.codeplex.com. You can sort of look through this on your own. You may have your own approach to picking the right one. This is how I do it, but this is how everybody's going to do it. So the first thing we do is we pick the first item in the merge dictionary. I'm going to jump back to the merge dictionary so we can look at it. It has two items in it. The first one is standard styles. The next one is custom. So here's standard. I go and create a new resource dictionary, set its source to where its location is. It loads that, prepares it for me. That's the first thing I need.
And so we should perhaps point out the special URI syntax there that's pointing to the application package so that you can get the style standards.xaml.
It's a good point. That ms-appx means whatever I ship with the install. right? So it comes with the package, right? Not something I download, that's in another location altogether. So yeah, great job. And then I create a second one, a second resource dictionary. Of course, again, I'm gonna jump back. I have the first resource dictionary standards, the next one is styles. So now I'm creating, or custom, I mean, now I'm creating custom, and its source is going to be whatever path I determine it's going to be based on that logic above. In this case, it's going to be, let's say, the orange one. It will go and prepare that set of resources for me. Then I create one more resource dictionary. And the reason is, I'm going to jump back to AppSAML again, that's because the whole thing is inside a resource dictionary. That's the one I'm about to create now. This is the main one, and so I called it main. And it has a property of merge dictionaries. I'm going to jump back again. This is the property, merge dictionaries, with these two inside it. So I set its initial startup values with standard and custom as part of it. Now I'm practically done. I've already created the resource dictionary, the main resource dictionary, and its two styles inside. Now, if you don't have the kind of ad hoc ones that are in your AppSAML, you might be done. Right? I could set it immediately. But because I do have these extra, I want to take care of those. These are the ones that they don't have anything to do with the colors. They don't have anything to do with the themes. These are just things that I'm using. So I want those to be here kind of globally reused. And anyway, so that's what this for loop does. This for loop passes through everything in the app.current.resources. And if it's not already in the, my new main, then it just adds it to it. That way I make sure I don't lose anything. Right. Again, I'll never see this SAML that it's creating. It's not SAML. I'll never see what it's creating. I'm just replacing it with the logical equivalent.
Absolutely.
This is the line that matters here. App.current.resources equals main. I basically say whatever resources value is, again, that's set right here. Whatever that is, I'm about to override it with my new resource dictionary called main.
Now, as soon as you assign that, bang, everything changes, yeah?
Yeah, no, I wish it did. Yeah. You would think you would call .refresh, dot update styles, dot whatever it is. But again, just like we were talking kind of earlier, where you have those styles in the different, if they have anything to do with the color, they're rendered when they're loaded. You have the same problem here, right? So your page is rendered and done. You can change those underneath values, and they're static properties, static resources, sorry. Those resources can change all they want. They're only read it when they're loaded. You can change them all you want. It never reflects on the page. How do you cause it to refresh?
Yeah, that's a great answer. So what do you do? Do you need to renavigate, or do you just tell it to redraw?
No, no, you're right. There, you have to renavigate. You cannot redraw. Mm-hmm. You can only renavigate. In fact, let me jump to how you do that. And this is the easiest way, because you want to protect your backstack. If you start navigating around too much, you start screwing up your backstack, and then your back button does things that users aren't expecting it to do. So here's the way that you reload. It's easy enough. I'll just zoom in here. And the easiest is to navigate. You can do one of two things. You can navigate to the current page, as long as the current page isn't going to blow up because it's expecting a parameter. Mm-hmm. And then go back, right? If you don't know if the page is going to blow up or not, all you have to do is navigate to a page that you've created just for this purpose, right? Like a blank or something like that. And navigate to the blank and then go back. Either way, the purpose of this navigation and back causes the page to reload without polluting your backstack. There is a caveat here. Not just the caveat of navigating to a page that doesn't expect a parameter, but there's also a caveat here of going back will always cause it to redraw and see your new style unless it's cached.
Unless it's cached, which is a great point, because we covered this, I believe, in our previous day's worth of modules, where we were talking about navigation and caching and different life cycles of pages and so on and so forth. Because again, if, as you say, the whole point of caching is to optimize the rendering. If you're pre-caching everything that's been pre-rendered, it's not going to reflect.
That's right, it's not. And you're not going to be able to dynamically change the navigation cache mode on, during navigation.
Yep.
So what you might think is, okay, well, I'll just set navigation cache mode to disabled. Then I'll navigate to it, and then I'll re-enable it. And that's, it's just not, it's not settable like that. And so you're going to need a new strategy. There's just no getting past it.
So, I mean, fundamentally what we're talking about is this sort of capability you need to design for from the outset, not only in terms of graphic design, but obviously in terms of architecture. If you're going to sort something like this, then you may want to create strategic locations where it's theme changing is supported,
right,
and disable the capability in the settings menu at that point in time, which may not be ideal, but they could deal with that scenario.
Yeah.
Or perhaps create a convention whereby you can only do it from the app hub.
Yeah, you can only do it from the app hub, or perhaps they make a change in it and you have to give them a dialogue that says, thank you, you've selected green. It will reflect the next time you start the app.
Right? Yeah.
There's sometimes there are just things you have to do because of technology, right?
Absolutely.
Anyway, so that gives a lot of power to your app to be able to swap between styles.
Feature.
It's not just colors. It's entire layouts can change. You can give it at the disposal of the user so they can swap between it. The developer can do it as well based on programmatic things, all because styles can control everything. And if you raise it up to a scope like application level, you can start changing those out real easily. It's really nice.
It is. It's very cool.
Yeah. Okay, so that's it. So we're talking about branding.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is the first way we can brand. We can brand based on logic, and then we can use different styles.
And we actually ended up inside Splash Screen to actually look at the code for branding.
Oddly enough.
It's strangely foreshadowing.
Yeah.
So why don't you start up the application?
I want to show you this slide just for a quick second.
Okay.
This slide says switching styles.
That's what we did. That's awesome.
This is the one I'm going to do. Extended Splash, right? This is a present to Jeff. This is my extended splash transition slide. Very
Jeff,
good.
We're transitioning.
When your application loads, Darren, you've only got a certain amount of time to load.
Yes.
It's just the way the framework is designed to make sure that the user isn't waiting forever, your app doesn't lock up their machine. And if you step past that threshold, it'll just terminate your app.
So it doesn't ask the user, do you want to continue running it? It's gone.
It just says, this is clearly a problem. We'll just kill it for you. That's kind of how it goes down, right? And so there's another thing that happens. When my app loads, it shows the splash screen. Remember in your, in fact, let me just pull up our app real quick. You had created over in the assets here, or in the demo, yeah, but here we go. A whole slew of files, right?
Yes.
They look great, by the way. You did a great job.
Awesome.
And each one has its own scale and all these things, but it's the splash screen that matters. The splash screen logo shows during load, but all it is a splash, is this image and the color we choose for the background during that time period.
Do you want to show that in the manifest?
Animation. Yeah, sure, you bet. In fact, if I were down in the app manifest here and I go to the splash screen settings, Can I do this? There you go. Great. Good enough. And anyway, so this background color of the splash screen, that's where we set the green so that it matches our logo and it looks really nice.
Yep.
The downside to the splash screen is that it's static.
It's
It doesn't do anything.
You don't
Nothing's
want it to be
moving.
Showing for a long time because it's like, okay, is this... I mean, it's part of the reason to a certain extent why applications get terminated if they take too long to start because that thing's sitting there and it looks unresponsive.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right. I might want a spinner. I might want a progress bar or something, right? Something to show that there's real work, and sometimes there is real work.
Yeah.
I need to go out to a web service, download a file. I need to go do whatever it is.
But while this thing is being displayed, your application isn't actually running. It's just starting.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so let's look at the pipeline now that we kind of understand the problem. And so this orange right here shows that the splash screen begins. And while the splash screen is running, the loaded event is running inside my application. I have the option to do anything that I want. That's the right time to do it, while you would think. And so I do all this preparation, and it takes quite a bit of time, and then the splash screen is dismissed. So I really hope that my preparation section is short enough that I don't extend past the threshold and my app is terminated.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, that entire long, this top one, you know, it's very long. The user has to stare at the static image, and they hope something's happening. They assume something's happening, but they don't really know, right? So it all around, it's bad, right? I'm at risk that my app could be terminated. The user's having a bad experience of a static image in their face.
Yeah, I mean, you might be reaching out to some external web-based resource, and you can't necessarily control the life cycle of that resource, i.e. how quickly it's going to respond.
Yeah.
And so if that web service has been particularly slow today, that could result in your application being killed on startup.
I think Barry had said he just upgraded to a 28.8 modem. It's pretty neat.
Yeah, was that from the 14.4?
Why did you pick that out of
Nice. You literally just told me that, too.
Exactly.
That's beautiful. So we need a solution, Darren.
Yes.
We need a solution so that if we
are going
out to get...
Because nobody wants their application to be killed.
No. And I mean, just because you're accessing a resource on the web doesn't mean you're doing something wrong.
Yeah.
And you really don't know their speed, right? I mean, I doubt it's 28.8, but it could be anything. What can we do?
Well, I think we should create an alternate splash screen experience.
So an alternate splash screen, an extended splash screen, is a splash screen that looks just like the regular splash screen.
Plus.
All right.
Because we want to give some form of interactive feedback to show that the application is still doing something.
Yeah.
And I think we have a control or a couple of controls that are useful for that.
Okay, I'm going to pull up our project and kind of show how we did it. And I think this is it's going to be brilliant. I mean, once you see how we did it, you'll never do it
you'll
any other
never
way.
You'll never need to learn anything else.
Okay, so again, it all starts in app, right? Everything starts in app. That's where the launched event is. And so here's on launched right here. That's an override that is the first thing to come. And so we'll show a couple things. So right now, once on launched runs, the splash screen is still visible.
So what causes on launched to run?
What?
The infrastructure. You know, basically, we're sitting here, and we launch our application from a tile.
I guess the user clicks it.
Yeah, we click a tile, and we start up, or we have some other ways to launch the application, which we'll talk to in a little bit. So these events that are in the app XAML are hooked into by the infrastructure to illustrate to us that the lifecycle of our application is changing.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's right. On launched, in fact, it's kind of peer is on activated.
Yes.
And we talked about that a little bit yesterday, if we can say it that way.
Yeah.
Where launched is when your app begins to run for the first time. Activated is where it's brought back. You know, it's
resumed.
Brought back to the front. Yeah. Right. Exactly. Anyway, so try not to look at the other logic here for a second, because you'll talk about that in just a sec.
Yeah.
We're talking about tiles.
Yeah.
This is where we really are. So the window.current is your application. I mean, that really is the foundation of your application. It's the full screen window of your store app. And its content currently is the splash screen. And so this allows us to say, so the first thing we do right when it's launched is say, the splash screen content needs to change to be a control that we've created, a control that looks just like the splash screen. So this is our extended splash. Now, as soon as we set the content, nothing happens. It has to be activated, and there's something special going on. As soon as I, in line 44, set the splash screen and instantiate it, it has to go and render it, right? And there's a millisecond or three that it takes to actually put it all together. And so if you just immediately activate it, there's going to be a flash because you have to wait for it to render.
So what is, most specifically, is the image that your image loads asynchronously. You specify a source, and everything else carries on, and your image downloads and renders at some point in the future, even if it's included as part of your application, which these images are. There's still that delay.
So the strategy is to not call activate right away, but here I'll show you our activate method. It's instead to use a timer, a dispatcher timer is what we use inside Windows 8, and to set its interval to be, and you can kind of feel this out, whatever's right, and this time we're using a full second. Don't swap from the splash to the extended splash for a full second. That gives it plenty of time to load everything up, and when it does, it's a seamless transition. You don't see a flicker at all. Mm-hmm. It's really nice. So on the tick event, so this will be the first second that occurs, then you stop the timer, of course, because there's no point in it, and you activate that content. Then, from that point forward, the user is looking at your extended splash screen.
Yep.
Very powerful.
Absolutely.
All right, so let me pull up our splash screen so we can kind of get a feel for it. The splash screen is where all the hard work is going to be done. In fact, if I were to jump back to our slide real quick, it's this green section, right? So it can go and go and go as long as it needs to. We don't have to worry about it being terminated by the framework because we've already dismissed the splash screen.
Of course, we need to be reasonable about this. We can't sit there and have it spinning for 10 minutes because then the user's going to terminate our app. You know, and at the end of the day, we want our users to engage with our creation, not necessarily dismiss it and tell all their friends it sucks.
Right. That's right. All right, so I'll kind of go through our loaded event. So this is where the extended splash screen loads. And so it kind of goes like this. There are a few debug pieces in here. So it begins. And then we await long-running actions. Right, so it's kind of encapsulated away, so we don't have to talk about all the stuff it does right now. But that's the one that could, you know, it goes out to, in this case, we know it logs us into Windows Live, it goes out to SkyDrive, does a couple other little things. Those could take a little while, depending on the user's bandwidth. Then it goes...
Or forever, if it's Barry.
Or forever. Hey. Well, it's your modem, man. It's not you. It's never you, Barry.
That was a 10-year-old story.
It's fresh now. It's fresh now. All right. So anyway, so then you create the frame. Remember the frame. The navigation framework is all like a browser, right? And so it has frames and pages.
Just so everyone knows, Barry is Jerry's imaginary friend.
There is no one here named Barry, is what's weird. I can see him. I don't know what everybody else's problem is.
I'm not here,
Jerry. Nice, nice. Okay, then we resume if we want to resume, right? If that ends up being a long-running action, we might have to put that up as well. And then we set the content just like we did before, and activate it, right? Anyway, so here, the splash screen is acting just like AppXAML was, but it gives an extra moment for these long-running actions to run. And then it's up to me to make the UI look however I want.
Yeah.
But it's important that I make the UI look exactly like the splash screen.
And this is where the environment kind of helps us out a little bit, because lots of things can happen whilst your application is starting up. You know, users can choose to make some actions. Perhaps they've launched it on a tablet and they're swinging around and they choose to move from landscape to portrait.
They're frisbee. They're throwing it like a frisbee.
Hey, Barry, look this.
And then they catch it and they're like, this stupid app, it hasn't caught up. But anyway, so we have this arrange image method that kind of goes through the fact that the splash screen is a reference to the original splash screen, like the real one. Mm-hmm. And so it tells us its location. It's in height and its height and width, its size, as well as its X and Y.
It's actually the location of the image we've supplied and where the splash screen has positioned it.
Yeah, no, you're right. I should have been more clear. You're right. It's the splash screen image. Where is it on the screen? Because you want your extended splash screen to match it to the pixel.
Yep.
To the pixel. If it's even one off, you might think it's no big deal. Honestly, it is no big deal. I mean, let's not get carried away. But if it is just one or two off, it is this annoying kind of flick.
Yeah. And ultimately, we're trying to produce these polished applications. And as we journey through building these applications, we find these little things dotted around an MSDN that document these capabilities and so on. And once you're aware of them, it takes a very little amount of time to put it in, especially once you've written it once. You can just move it across into your other applications. And it just adds that level of polish that makes these applications professional.
Yeah, it's worth it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's worth it. I mean, it doesn't take that long, and we're all lazy at heart. That's the
exactly.
problem.
Yeah, where's my code gen?
Okay, so sometimes the splash screen is not the right thing to do, though. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't mean for an app. I think it's always the right thing to do. But not every use case. For example, if we were to go back on how it was called, let's see, in AppXAML here, we have this little if statement that's checking to see if it's a tile or if it is not a tile, which
is my demo gone. God.
Right? Yeah, so if it's being activated or if it's being run for the first time. Mm-hmm. So talk to me about tiles. How would I use a tile in the first place?
So obviously, I say obviously.
It's obvious to me.
It's obvious to most, I hope. But when we install a Windows Store app, the application creates a primary tile that exists on the
Barry,
show
my slide.
Oh, we need Jeff to know that we've transitioned over to secondary tiles.
Yeah,
so show
I want
the
him
slide.
To know. He
stalks us if we don't show this thing.
So we're about to change now. Now let's talk about secondary tiles, Derek.
Yeah, secondary tiles, great. So when we install an application from the store, the infrastructure and the environment creates for us a primary tile for the application.
Every app has its primary tile.
Exactly. And we can't influence that directly in terms of what's being created at this particular point. Now we can create live tiles and those kind of things. And we're not talking about live tiles in this scenario.
Yeah.
Yeah, we touched on those in previous sessions. Mm-hmm. So if you look at this slide, then we see that the top slide is actually the wide tile. And that's what we specified as the default for this application.
Apps can have two types of tiles. They can have both the wide and the square.
And the square. And as we mentioned, there's also a bunch of templates that can automate and change those particular size and shapes. Secondary tile, however, gives us the ability to incorporate richer functionality into our application. If we have specific areas of content that we wish to be able to navigate to, and we can do that directly, then creating a secondary tile allows us to put an additional launch point on the user's start screen that they can click on that should take us directly to that content. So that's the point of those things.
And Silverlight could do this, and it was deep linking in Silverlight, where you could skip the main page and go straight to a specific something.
Absolutely. And so effectively, these secondary tiles give us that capability. And so we have a whole creation environment that supports that. Now, Jerry was already in the particular area of the code that showed how we can detect whether a tile has been clicked on what type of tile.
Yeah.
So by default, the tile ID of the, if you show my code, my code? I'm not in PowerPoint.
If I was actually imagining Barry, yep. I would imagine him so different.
Exactly.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Exactly. No worries. So anyway, moving swiftly on. So we were showing the unlaunched event, and we actually get an argument that's passed as the unlaunched event arguments, which incorporates a tile ID. By default, that will be set to app, indicating it's the primary tile. If it's not equal to that, then it's going to be a secondary tile, and we'll go through how that gets set up in a second.
Can you set the tile ID of a secondary tile to app?
We probably could, and that would be confusing.
That would be awful. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
That's funny.
Top tip, don't do that.
Right, exactly.
Okay, let me actually just run up the application for a moment.
So tile ID equals app is like saying tile.isPrimary.
Yes.
In a way. There is no isPrimary, I'm just saying.
So we're starting up the application. You can probably see the progress bar across the top there.
Yeah, that's nice. So extended splash screen.
That extended splash was awesome. So now if I want to navigate into a piece of content, so I'm going to select this tile here, and I'm moving into the detail view. One of the things we've got here is an app bar that pops up, and I'll show you a little bit how I get it to show and then dismiss after a couple of seconds and so on. But one of the features that we have on here is a pin to start. So we've got a button on here that we can use to pin to start. And so what the idea here is...
You wouldn't have pin to start on the hub, because that's where you go with the primary tile.
Yeah, and so it's already pinned.
But this pin to start is in the one record.
Yes, so we're in a particular module here, object-oriented programming, managed languages, and C#.
And that was like, a good one.
This is an awesome one, this.
Yeah.
And we want to be able to get to it every time. Yeah, as I say, 50% of that is attractive and 50% is not.
Yeah, that's what I think too.
Exactly. And you're wrong. But anyway, I want to pin this to my start. And so I can click this button. And what happens here is I get a preview of...
Now, that box that just popped up, that is a XAML control.
That's a pop-up XAML control, yes, that's going to get positioned relative to here. And I'll go into how that's actually being produced in a moment.
Okay.
And this gives us a preview of the tile. We can also edit the title that we want to place on here, should we so wish. I'm just going to choose the default.
Okay.
And I'm going to hit pin to start. So that has now created a secondary tile on our start menu.
Now, from the user's experience, this is different than the phone. If I were to do this on Windows Phone...
It would take you to your start screen and you would see the tile.
Yeah.
This has happened in the background. We've not interrupted your experience of the application because we have assumed you're going to continue and want to operate.
Now, pull up your start screen. Show me the button for a second. A common developer question is, I see it showed up at the end.
Yep.
What do I have to do to make that button show up at the beginning, right? I don't want it to be at the end because users lose it.
It's basically up to, the system puts it where the system's going to put it. It's
you
up to the user.
You can't control that.
Yes.
Yeah,
it's like so many things that the user has to be given the power to arrange their start screen as they wish. Mm-hmm. You can't dominate their start screen. It's theirs. Equally, you'll notice that I demonstrated creating it through a user action. That is the only way you can create a secondary tile.
We were talking about that earlier, about the different types of events inside Windows 8.
Yep.
User-initiated events and programmatic events.
Yeah.
And so programmatic events, I can't just cycle through and start creating secondary tiles?
You cannot spam their start screen with hundreds of tiles for your application.
That pop-up that said, did it say confirm or did it say create or whatever it said?
Accept, I think it was.
Yeah. If I created two secondary tiles, would they see that twice?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So that they could dismiss it if they didn't want to create one.
Okay, good. So they're always in control. You can't just blast out secondary tiles. Perfect.
Exactly.
I get it.
And so now if I click on here, we actually come straight back into the application where we were. If I move back and then come back to the environment, the start screen, and click on it, it takes me straight back into that screen again.
Bypassing all the navigation for you.
None of the extended splash being shown or whatever. But it's still got the back stack so we can move back to the home page and so on and so forth. So we haven't broken that experience of the application.
Yeah.
But anyway, if I go back into here, What we also see is we've detected that the state has changed and we actually have a secondary tile for this location. So now instead of showing pin again, we show unpin.
So I can ask if there is a secondary tile already there.
Correct.
That's nice.
And so if I want to unpin it, I can do that. I get the ability to confirm or not.
Now, did you create that dialogue that just popped up?
No, I did not. Again, the system provides that.
All
I need to do is tell the system where to position it.
Where the button is you click.
Exactly.
I got it. Cool.
So now what I'll do is go in and show some of the code related to this.
Okay.
So we showed this startup scenario, and so we showed the tile ID. If we have something that's not equal to app, mm-hmm. and we were running,
that's the important double.
Yes.
Yeah, and you're running already.
Then we're going to go straight to tile ID.
Which basically says, skip the splash screen.
Skip the splash screen. Otherwise, we're going to go through the splash screen and do basically the same thing after we've initialized the application. Because we need to set up the data, we need to load in the data, and so on and so forth. So that's that part. Now let's have a look at the XAML of the detail page. Or the XAML of the detail page, he says. Come on.
Do you mean the XAML of the detail page?
It keeps reorganizing underneath me. Do you see that? Every time I try to click on it, it moves.
That's by design, dude.
Exactly. So what we have is we have an app bar, and we have a button on the app bar. And so let me change the size of the XAML viewer here. So we can come down, and we can say, here is my app bar.
Yep.
Called it detail app bar. Inherited standards, background, theme brush, resources, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
Inside there, we have a grid, and inside there, we have a stack panel. It's traditional to have two stack panels. One's aligned to the right, one's aligned to the left.
Yeah.
And you group different types of actions in those. We only have a very simple app bar, and so we have a very straightforward one. We have a print command, which we'll talk about later on. That's an upcoming module. But we also have these two buttons here. One's for pinning, and one's for unpinning. And so we also are binding to show pin button state, and we're using a converter, one to convert Boolean to visibility.
Oh, I see. So you are showing just one button, but actually there are two there, the unpin and the pin, and you're just hiding them.
Exactly. And we're using a style that unpin app button style and a pin app bar button style.
Hmm.
And if we click out to where these are defined, and we see that this is in app.xaml.
Yeah.
That we have these two styles, and we're using the extended symbols of the Sego UI symbol font. And these are our two pin and unpin icons.
Oh, so like we talked about in the previous module, when we were talking about styling and inheritance, you're using based on so that they all automatically look like the app bar button style.
Yep.
And then you're just adjusting these things.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. You know, let me throw in one thing. This is a little bit right field, but I meant to say it a few during localization.
Mm-hmm.
Is you see those automation properties .name.
Yeah, I was just about to do that one.
Carry on.
So we're setting our string values for the control, and we can see that the app bar button has a little bit of a different syntax for setting string values and so on and so forth. This automation properties .name. If we come back to the XAML, we also see that we have a UID, detail unpin.
Nice.
So that ties into our resources. So if I look in strings, NUS resources.resw, this is the syntax we can use to use that XUID capability.
Nice.
To bind pin
well,
to
start. Well, that's serious right there. Look at that syntax.
Yeah, so clearly it's not the most elegant. You know, we're introducing a namespace here to qualify that this property's name is part of this namespace. Mm-hmm. It's not ideal. You know, it would be great if it was just detailpin.name.
Okay. I think it's
okay. But
right.
Once you've established the convention, you know what you're seeing whenever you see these things.
Yeah.
So again,
but at least you can do it.
At least you can do it.
Now, I see you set name, which of course is the visible text on the button. But I think it's worthwhile saying that if you're using a screen reader and you're using some sort of accessibility device that helps you read it, that application automation automation ID is the string that shows up in the reader.
Mm-hmm.
And so here you're setting names, so visually we see that. But if I was impaired in some way, that application ID would also be valuable. So it makes sense to have a resource for both name and application ID if you intend to cater to every audience.
Yeah, absolutely. Great point. So those are how we control the button. And if we look at the preview, we can see because resources aren't being evaluated during design time that we actually don't see the text.
Ah, yeah.
Which is kind of interesting. So that's that side of the house. What we also see is we're doing something a little bit different, perhaps, is we're using a view model. Throughout this entire application, we're actually using the MVVM pattern. So we're using view models and we're binding. And so rather than mapping to click events, we're using commands. Mm-hmm. And so we haven't really talked about how we're instantiating our view model. But basically what we have up here is we have a little bit of XAML that is setting the data context. And if you've seen our earlier sessions on XAML, you'll understand that this is creating an instance of this class and is placing that value in this property of the page.
Yeah.
So we're actually injecting in a data
just
context.
Like you do in C#, only it's actually executing in the designer.
Yeah, so it's pretty cool. So this is how we can see this design time data, is we actually have a view model that's providing design time data, and then when we execute the application,
it gets real data.
It gets real data, yeah. Which is pretty cool.
That is nice.
So anyway.
Well, let me back up just for a second, or just reiterate what you were going on. We've said this before, but it's worth saying again, the model view view model is the design pattern intentionally for XAML. If you're building a XAML application, MVVM is the way you really need to build your application. Mm-hmm. Again, you could do it any way you want,
yep.
But that is the path of least resistance. It's made for you. It's meant for XAML. It makes life really easy.
Perfect. So we've got a command. Now, the other thing that I've done here is I've specified a command parameter. And I'm actually passing in using this binding syntax.
Look at that relative source. That is beautiful. Now, what does that do? We didn't talk about that last time.
We kind of alluded to it, but we didn't go into much detail. But fundamentally, what this is saying is the value of this command parameter is relative to the current control. And the relative path that we're resolving is, in fact, ourself. So the value of the command parameter is being set to this instance of the button.
So are you passing in the record or are you passing in the control?
I'm passing in the control.
So literally now in the view model, you have reference back to this button.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Now there are purists who will be turning around saying, well, now you're tightly coupling your view model to the view. And you're correct.
But now, is it true most of those purists live in Norway?
Good Lord, man.
it's a lot of purity.
So the... So
you're passing the button into the
passing model. The button into it. What I was going to say is that in every framework, there are going to be edge cases where, because of the way that you're tied into the platform and the way that we need to show this pop-up overlay related to the command that's being initiated, if we don't want to put that into the code behind, we have to pass in the UI element.
Yeah.
Because we have to establish where that UI element is being rendered on the screen to be able to position the other pop-up relative to that.
Ah, this goes back to that pop-up saying, do you want to create the tile? You have to figure out where this button is on the screen so you can put that over it.
Absolutely.
Oh, okay. This
so that's how this is working.
It.
So quickly, before I dive into this, I just want to quickly show how we show the app bar and pop it up on when we go into the page, and then we'll proceed into the actual secondary tiles itself. So we've got a timer. Well, you mentioned that this is a dispatch timer.
Yes.
And that's what we use. We have this method called setup app bar timer. This gets set up during the load cycle of the page. So we create a new instance of our dispatch timer. We specify it with a duration of 3 seconds.
Yeah.
We subscribe to the tick event and we start it. So during the load, that occurs.
I see. So this is just a friendly thing to say, here's the app bar. And then it's out of your way.
Exactly.
Because not all users go find the app bar. So
exactly.
This is sort of saying, we've got some functionality down here. We don't want to be in your way.
Exactly. And so you can hint that it's there. People can see it. It moves out of the way. If they want to get back to it, they can swipe up. They can right click or whatever.
Yeah.
But it helps the discoverability of some of the features and functions of these applications. So I'll just pop that in there because that's a pretty useful scenario.
That is nice. Easy, too.
Yeah. So if we look at the... this is the view model. So we don't need that. Mm-hmm. So we have secondary tiles. So the really cool thing about secondary tiles is it's actually very, very simple to use.
Okay.
It's very simple to integrate.
So you say.
So I say. So what I'm doing here is during the initialization of the view model, I basically call out. So this is a capability of the platform that turns around and says, check to see if a secondary tile with the supplied ID already exists.
That's nice.
And I use that to toggle the state of my show pin button, which is a property that is implemented using iNotify property changed, so that the
you hide UI, and show the button, depending
exactly.
Which one's
I can toggle which view is being opened. I also pass in an instance of the app bar because I want to check this state whenever the app bar is opened. Now, the reason for this is I might launch the application. I might be on the detail view of the application, and then I might swap to another app.
Yeah.
I might bring up the start screen. My application
you might
is
even
still
delete
running.
Your tile.
If I then go and delete my tile.
Oh, okay. So you can remove a secondary tile from your start screen without doing it through the app.
Absolutely. You know, I flick out. Oh, I've already deleted it.
But anything, you can right-click and
say... Exactly, right-click and delete it. So this will detect that whenever the app bar is opened, it rechecks the state to see if a secondary tile exists and toggles this property. So that will switch back between which of the buttons are visible. So that's
nice.
Some core, very, very simple and straightforward infrastructure.
Which, by the way, this is super common. This is the way it's done.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The next one is we have this command. This command is bound to those two buttons. The buttons share the same command.
Yep. Delegate command to be. And by the way, my blog is jerrynixon.com, kind of the home of the delegate command and the typed delegate command that we're using here.
Mm-hmm. There are many implementations of that, but that's certainly they're all implementing the I command pattern that's part of the platform.
Oh, surely, yeah.
So I'm using a property here is sticky, and that means that when I'm interacting with the app bar, and I have a pop-up up, it stops the app bar disappearing whilst I'm working
with
it.
You lose your context
exactly,
otherwise. Yeah.
Which is a little bit confusing. And I also toggle that off at the bottom when I finish doing whatever I'm doing.
Yeah, nice.
So now, once again, I check to see whether my secondary tile exists.
Okay.
If it does, then the only option that I've created in my UI is, if it exists, you're going to delete it. And so I wait for...
Oh, I see. That constructor where you pass in the child ID, that just finds it and gets the secondary tile reference.
Exactly. And so it's going to bring that in. So it's only going to create it if one doesn't exist. It's going to basically retrieve back the existing instance if I do that. So this isn't creating a secondary tile. It's creating a reference to the secondary tile.
Got it. And then request delete for selection async is very informative there because they can deny it. They don't
exactly.
have to do
You're
it.
You're only requesting that the user deletes from your system. And again, this can only happen if the user's initiated the action.
Yeah.
And so they can change their mind.
User's king.
Now, this is why we needed the button, because what we're actually going to do is get the rectangle on the screen where the button is displayed.
Yeah.
We're then telling it that when the pop-up, the verification pop-up occurs, we want it to be placed above this rectangle.
Makes sense to me, yeah, exactly.
And so
that's great because even larger, smaller monitors and orientation changes, this handles it all. It always puts it in the right spot.
Correct. And, you know, it's not going to be off the screen. Even if we're butted up right against the right, it's going to shift it left but still above.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Kind of automagic.
So that would be the deletion scenario, and we've seen that UI. To create it, we need a couple of things. We need to show, okay, what's the logo that we're actually going to display? What's the tile image that we're going to put there?
Sure.
This is some additional information we can pass in during the startup. You know, in app.xaml, CS, in here, args.argument gives us that value. So we could actually do some additional work if we wish to supply some additional information. An example would be we could serialize an object into JSON and pass that around.
Yeah, that's very nice. You could have a secondary tile that goes to a record that's not even loaded, but you hand the initial JSON.
Yep.
And it deserializes it, shows it, and then behind the scenes goes and gets the updated version.
Absolutely.
From the
Because
the
again,
web.
We're trying to create a responsive application.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool trick actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, so then, the ID, the args, those are all invisible. They're not a visual thing. You make it look like it's an English sentence, but that's just for us debugging.
Absolutely. this is us actually creating an instance of the secondary tile, and we are passing in all of the various elements that we need to be able to create this. So this is the ID that we use during the startup to work out what's going in. This child record actually represents the detail, i.e. the episode that we're viewing on the details page. This is the title of the episode, so that goes in and shows as the title on the tile.
On the tile, got it.
And that was the thing that we had the option to edit, should we so wish. Description, again, we're pulling in a more detailed description, so that's available for viewing. Tile activation arguments, which is what we created up here. Yep.
Could be JSON, could be anything, could be blank.
Yep. Specifying our tile options, so we're saying show name on logo.
Yeah.
So this is the type of tile, and what we want to do, we have a number of options here. We can show name on logo, which is what we just selected.
Yeah.
But we can also show name on wide logo. We can also do copy on deployment, which don't really touch on, but you can actually move around secondary tiles as you install an application on another device under the same account. But
you got to pay attention when you're doing it that way.
That's pretty nifty.
Yep.
And then we specify the logo, i.e. the image that we want to use.
Yep, just the URI. It does all the rest for you. And that URI, by the way, could be on the internet?
No, it absolutely can't. It's got to be part of your package.
That's right. Well, it could be a local as well, but it can't be remote.
Yes. So now we also specify foreground text. I know the color of my imagery, so I want my font to be light.
Mm-hmm.
We don't necessarily want it to be driven by the theme, because you might have a dark theme, but if you've got a really light image, you don't want white text showing up on top of that. So that's why this is specific to the logo. And then we can also specify additional types of images if we wanted to show a small logo, how this appears in a preview when we zoom out from the start, you know, when we view all of the applications.
That's the small logo. Also, when you view all.
Yeah, or when we search.
There you go. That's the small logo as well. I got it. So those are all important logos to have. All right.
Okay. So those are set up. And then finally.
Oh, look how similar it is to the delete or remove.
Exactly.
Request create.
And again, we pass in our element for the button so it knows where to position this above.
Yeah.
And that's it done.
It really is straightforward. I mean, we walk through it slowly, but I mean, that's just a handful of lines of code.
Exactly.
And it is pretty clean. And last time we were talking about queuing, you know, that's something different, adding notifications to a tile so that they can move between content. This is the generic, just the secondary tile and its base information.
Yep.
There it is, and it's gone. You can find it, you can remove it, and the user is always in control, so you're not jacking around with their start screen. Show me at work.
So here it is popping up. I can click pin to start.
Yep.
We now have it on our start screen.
Yeah.
I can right-click on this and say unpin from start.
Yeah, do it, yeah.
If I now go back into my application,
okay,
fingers crossed.
My fingers are crossed.
Bring it up.
Pin again.
Pin to start.
Nice.
So it knows that it was deleted from there, so now we only have the pin. And there you go.
All right, makes sense to me.
Perfect.
So let's see, we're talking about...
You are the target audience.
Yeah. Is anybody else here? Just me and Barry.
I've got
an awesome job, Captain. All right, so we're talking about branding, the things that you can do inside your application, not only to make it more useful, but to make it unique and to make it special for your what you're doing inside your app. You want to bring as much value as you can. Remember, we're in a cosmic battle between us and the uninstall button. That's what we're trying to bring more value and as well as promote as much of the unique differentiation inside your app. That's what it's about as far as branding. So we have custom styles. We talked about how you can switch between those styles so you can have themes. We also talked about the extended splash screen, not just so you can do more at startup, which sometimes is important, but also so you can bypass the risk of the of being terminated without being because you've taken too long, but also because you can give a better user experience with an animated splash screen. And then finally, we saw all the tiles that you can do. We talked about the fact that you have a primary tile and you can control that and add notifications to it, but you also have secondary tile. That gives you the ability to deep link into your application bypassing the navigation that might be in there, and you can use that then also to show unique information on that specific record. So it's up to you. You can add all of these or you can add none of them, but they're all at your disposal to use. And perfect, Darren. I think we should take a break. This one's longer than the normal. Let's take a nice, long, 11-minute lunch.
No, it's not lunch yet.
No. How long? Barry, How long is the normal Norwegian lunch break? Do you know?
Well, being only partly Norwegian, my guess is about an
partly
hour.
Norwegian.
Yeah. But we're actually only on module 3, and we have one more module before we break for lunch.
No, this is module 4. Is this module 3?
Yes.
All right, so before we break for lunch, Darren, I think we've got enough time for one more module, right? Let's do take 10 minutes, and we'll see you in 10 minutes.